Welcome, friends, to Wesley. We are so glad that you have chosen to join us this morning, especially if you're a guest. We would love to know more about you. And that's why we have all this sign-in stuff out here. You can wear your name tag or not. That's optional. But we do like to get as much information from you as possible, even your credit card and Social Security. Obvious reasons. No, I'm kidding. Well, we have a lot going on at this church per usual. It's why it's such a great, one of the reasons why it's such a wonderful church. And coming up is Trunk or Treat. Now you say, Trunk or Treat? That's not until the 29th of October, but we need lots of candy. So I was told to announce that, and you could store all that in my office. September 12th, which is just 2 days away, the Wowzers, Women of Wesley, will be studying the Book of Ruth. So all Women of Wesley and friends are welcome. Wacky Wednesday kicks off this week. Can you believe it? It's here already. It's going to be awesome. I'm looking forward to it. My first Wacky Wednesday experience. 5:30 is supper. 6 o'clock will be student ministry activities. And at 6 p.m., there'll be an adult Bible study as well as grief support. So there's really something for everybody there. And that's good. And grief support, I've mentioned that. Patsy Edmonds will be leading that. So we know that'll be good. If you're in need of any type of grief support, we welcome you to that. We also have a confirmation meeting after Wacky Wednesday at 7 in the Journey classroom. I'll be at that as well as Stephanie Gonzalez and Marilyn Myers. And this is for all sixth graders or youth older than sixth grade that have not been yet confirmed. So that is also a lot happening on Wednesday, and that'll be after Wacky Wednesday at 7. Also coming up, we have another mission day, but there's been a schedule change on that from not this coming Saturday, but it'll be down the road on another date, probably September 30th. Now, I want to spend just a quick moment on this. Back to Church Sunday is next week, so we want to pack the pews. This is what we're doing for Roundup this year. We want to pack the pews, invite neighbors, friends, strangers, enemies, frenemies, whatever. Invite them. And it's kind of like an open house for people to see our church, because they're going to, see what we're all about in worship, in one worship service. And then they're going to get to eat, and that makes everything better. Even if the sermon stinks, well, if you get to eat afterwards, man, that's good. And it's going to be good, because I know where it's coming from. It's coming from Billy Joe's Barbecue, so we know it's going to be good. Sunday school next week will be at this hour, 9 o'clock, okay? So 9 o'clock Sunday school, 10 o'clock worship service, and 11 o'clock lunch provided. That's all I have for now. I think that's good. Let us stand and worship and glorify our Lord Jesus Christ.
Sometimes you gotta dance through the darkness, sing through the fire, praise when it don't make sense. You gotta step down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta shout it from the mountain, louder in the valley, trusting that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere, praise, give him praise, give him praise. Of all of the praise. Sometimes shout it till the doors swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I'll praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath, I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. I'll praise you anywhere. Oh, on mountain or valley, I know that you're with me there. I'll praise you anywhere.
All my life you have. we go into the presence of the Father. Let's pray. Good morning, Father. It is such a privilege and a joy and a delight to be here in your house this morning. God, we give you thanks and praise for who you are. That we could come and be here, and there's nothing to separate us from you. You are holy and sovereign. You are almighty. You're our healer and redeemer. And you forgive us. God, we have so much to be thankful for. And we take just a moment to express the gratitude on our hearts for who you are to each one of us. God, we give you thanks. Your word tells us that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what you have planned for those who love you. And God, that's exciting to us. We love who you are, and we love the things you have planned for us. So God, help us to walk in your ways. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you, to not look to the ways of this world, and to not be self-reliant. Help us to depend only on you, God. We give you thanks, God, that you are our healer. And there are those among us who need healing. Those in our families, in our circles. And we silently lift them to you now. God, we give you thanks that you heal. Father, we also ask for your comfort for those who've lost loved ones. We thank you for your promises and for the hope of eternal life. And we thank you that you won the victory, and now the victory is ours. Thank you, Jesus. God, we ask for your forgiveness for all the ways that we fail you, for the times that we turn our backs on you, for the times that we just blatantly sin against you. God, we thank you that we can repent of our sins and you would forgive us and heal us, and that you would lead us in a path right back to you. This morning, Father, as we worship together with this community of faith, we pray that it's pleasing in your sight. Would you open our ears and our hearts and our minds to hear your voice and what you have to say to us? God, make us want you more than anyone else, more than anything else. Crush down our idols, God, and let us only want you. And this is our heart cry, God. And now we join together as the body of Christ, and we say the prayer that Jesus taught when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now if you'll receive this offering of music as we're mindful of our giving back to God.
just a story. I believe in the life of Jesus. I believe that he conquered death. I believe in the resurrection. I believe he's coming back again. I believe that his spirit's with us. I believe that he gives us power. I believe that he is the Son of God. I believe it. Said I got here on my own, I'd be lying, 'cause my eyes have seen the goodness of the Father. We're the ones he loves, we're the ones that he so loves. Oh, I can't deny it. Oh no, hey, I believe in the life of Jesus. I believe that he conquered death. I believe he's coming back again. I believe that his spirit's with us. I believe that he gives us power. I believe that he is the Son of God. I believe it. I believe it. I believe it. I believe it. I believe in the life of Jesus. I believe it. I believe it. I believe it. We cry, I believe that he conquered death. I believe in the resurrection. I believe, yeah. I believe that his spirit's with us. I believe that he gives us power. I believe he is the Son of God.
The children and tweens will come down. We'll now have our children and tweens message. Come on down. Look at all these kiddos. Good group here. I'm going to put a commercial in. You know what a commercial is?
Yes.
Yeah? Well, Wacky Wednesday starts this Wednesday.
Yay!
Yeah.
Wacky Wednesday.
We love Wacky Wednesday. Well, that's starting this week. So, Wednesday, something for kids, tweens, youth, and even adults. All right. Have you ever had a bad day? Yeah, I have. I've had a very bad day sometimes. Maybe you did something bad. You had a bad result on a test. Or a friend said something mean to you. We've all had bad days, haven't you? Soccer game was a bad time. Yeah. So there was a city of Corinth. And they were having a bad time. The church in Corinth was having a bad time. And so a man named Paul wrote them a letter to give them encouragement and to help them. Sometimes
when I have a very bad, horrible day, I need something to make me feel better. The word that we have here is comfort. Comfort means to make something better, right? Yeah. Sometimes I wrap up in this blanket right here. This is a special blanket. My mama made this. And I love it because it's big and it's warm and it makes me feel comfort, right? I love this blanket. So sometimes we need something that makes us feel better. You know what else makes us feel better? Helping each other. It does. You're ahead of me. But you know what the best comfort is? God. God comforts us. There's so many things in the Bible here, the verses, that say, I will be with you through it all. I will give you comfort. Yeah. Why does God comfort us? We may be sad. Zoe? He died for our sins. You're right. He gives us comfort because he loves us. He loves us from our head to our toes. He loves all of us. But you know what else? Here in this Bible, the words that Paul wrote to Corinth, he says, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God for all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. So he comforts us because he loves us, and so we can comfort other people. Yeah. So our tweens during VBS, they made some cards. Yeah, see, they're pretty cards. And they have some words on them that are comforting for people. And we have Miss Jennifer here and Patsy and Betty that go and deliver shut-in meals that give comfort to people. So just like God comforts us, our tweens wrote these letters so that they can comfort someone else. So God gives us comfort so that we can comfort others. So this week, remember, if you've had a bad time or a sad time, that you can feel God wrap his arms around you and give you comfort. And you can give comfort to someone else. You can give them a hug or a smile. You can help them when they need comfort. So let's pray. Dear God, we are so glad and thankful that you comfort us when we are having bad times. You wrap your loving arms around us and give us comfort. Help us to see where we might be a comfort to others when they are having a bad time. Amen.
Well, it is good to be with you again as we examine God's Word this morning. We are in 2 Corinthians, the beginning of 2 Corinthians. particularly 1 through 7. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God that is in Corinth, including all the saints throughout Achaia, grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation, who consoles us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to console those who are in any affliction with the consolation with which we ourselves are consoled by God. For just as the sufferings of Christ are abundant for us, so also our consolation is abundant through Christ. If we are being afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation. If we are being consoled, it is for your consolation, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we are also suffering. Our hope for you is unshaken, for we know that as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in consolation. This is the word of God for the people of God. Before I get started, I do want to have one more plug for next Sunday. Please invite somebody again, who neighbors, friends, relatives, people maybe who haven't been back to church in a while. We'd love to have them here and have a great celebration. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. This is truly your time. So I need the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and I call upon the Holy Spirit to come. Come, Holy Spirit, anoint my words so that my words go forth through the meditations of my heart and the lips of my mouth to the hearts of your hearers. We thank you for blessing this time, and we pray all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Well, this is actually the fourth letter that was written to the church in Corinth. Let me rephrase that. It was one of four letters, but we lost the other two. I mean, I didn't lose them. But they have been lost. So this is the second letter, and we trust that this is what we need from God, that we just needed the two letters from Corinthians. Paul planted this church years prior, and it was so dear to him. And the church was kind of a mess, and some things started to get in the church from outside the church. One of the things that got in there was some slanderous stuff about Paul. And then that started outside the church and whittled its way in the church. And so there was some false teaching and all this slander towards Paul. And Paul was kind of suffering with this, but he was also mentioned here that he suffered in Asia, which is Asia Minor. You know, Paul suffered a lot for the gospel of Christ. I mean, he was beaten, he was imprisoned, he was ridiculed, he was chastised, he was chased out of town. I mean, it was brutal. And so this letter starts off with talking about suffering and comfort. Now, the NRSV uses the word consolation, but in the New King James, which I often use, it's comfort. But we're going to get into that in a second. But Paul was suffering. And the interesting thing about Paul was when he suffered, he looked at it as an opportunity. Now, when I suffer, I'm just trying to find a way out of the suffering. But Paul saw it as an opportunity to grow and put another tool in his pastor's toolbox, if you will. Now, when I suffer, that may cross my mind at some point, but it is quickly gone because I'm focused on myself when I'm suffering. But Paul looked at it much differently. Paul knew that the sufferings that he was enduring was for Christ, and that the comfort that he was receiving was from the God of all comfort, and that he could use that in his ministry to help others in the race of endurance that we're all in on this journey with Christ. He also knew that he could use the comfort. He says, and look at what he says here. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." So the God of all comfort, how does that play itself out? Well, there are three ways where I believe it plays itself out. And the first one is through others or each other. Paul says as much here. He says as much right in our passage today. He says, "For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ." But listen to this. "Now, if we are afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effective for enduring the same sufferings which we also suffer. Or if we are comforted, it is for your consolation and salvation." In other words, what Paul is saying is that when you go through affliction and are comforted, you can now comfort others. You have that tool in your ministerial toolbox to comfort others. It's a beautiful thing that God's comfort flows through us to others. That's one of the ways that God comforts, is through each other. This church is a great example of that. I've seen it in my nearly 2 months here. I've seen this church comfort each other, and it's a beautiful thing. And so, you know, when you put your arm around somebody, when you listen to somebody, when you are with somebody who is so distraught and you are feeling their tears and their pain, that is comforting, and that is participating in the God of all comfort. So that comfort that we've received, because I'm going to tell you something that's not very popular, and that is that God comforts us, yes, because he loves us in our affliction, but also so that we can become comforters. Truly. Now, I know that's not popular. It doesn't sound good. Oh, great. I get to suffer so then I can be a comforter. Great. You know, none of us are like jumping up in joy about that. But that's one of the reasons that God allows affliction in our lives, so that we become comforters. And it's a beautiful thing to watch that comfort flow through other Christians to other believers and other people in need. It's really a beautiful thing. So through each other and others is one way. The other way is the Bible itself, the Word of God. You know, the Word of God gives us so much hope, and hope is comforting, right? You know, whether we're going through something and we're looking through the Psalms, Psalm 91, Psalm 23, maybe it's Romans 8:28, maybe it's John 14:1-6, which we talked about yesterday at Hal's Celebration of Life, where it's like, hey, Jesus says, I'm going to come back. I'm coming back, and when I come back, I'm going to take you with me. In fact, I'm going to go prepare a place for you right now. So the Bible gives us comfort. And then we have the Holy Spirit. One of the words for the Holy Spirit is the Comforter. Now, there's a lot of confusion about the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is God, not only God inside of us, not only the Comforter, but these very different, all these different functions of different hats that the Holy Spirit wears. He is many things, but one of the things that he is the Comforter. And what's so interesting is the Greek word for Comforter, the Greek word, let me rephrase that. The Greek word for the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, is called Paraclete. P-A-R-A-C-L-E-T-E. Paraclete. Now, what's particularly interesting about that is the words that Paul is using here that we read in the English for comfort, that word is actually paraklesis. P-A-R-A-K-L-E-S-I-S. It's the same from the same family as paraclete. And this type of comfort, friends, that Paul is talking about is so deep. You know, when we think of a beautiful portrayal of comfort, we think of a crying child in the arms of a loving parent. That's a sweet picture of comfort. But paraklesis goes so much deeper than that. It's a walking beside. It's walking along with this type of comfort and encouragement. It's support all the way through the storm. It's almost indescribable. And so that's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is providing that paraklesis comfort to each of us. And this is how Jesus lives out the promise that I will never leave you nor forsake you. This is how he lives out the promise that he is going to be the God of all comfort. Because he's in us. Remember, when the disciples and Jesus had that conversation where Jesus said, look, I'm going away, but you're going to be better off when I leave. And the disciples said, what are you talking about? And Jesus was essentially saying, right now I am outside of you, but soon I'm going to be right in here. I'm going to be living inside you as the Spirit of Christ. Now the Holy Spirit is many things. He is a person separate all to himself, part of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He's also the Spirit of Christ. He's the advocate. He's the comforter. He is the convictor. He lets us know when we sin. But today we focus on the comfort. And all three persons of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, participate in this comfort. I often say that God is close to the brokenhearted. Well, he is. Whenever you have been, and I think this is true for most believers, probably all believers, when we are going through something, whether it's major grief, whether it's something that we went through or going through, and we should not experience any comfort or peace inside, and we have that strange peace, you ever experienced that? That's the Holy Spirit. That's the Paraclete. The Holy Spirit. So through others, through the Bible, and through the Holy Spirit, the God of all comfort works. And so I ask you today, you know, who in here may need comfort? You know, this church is so good at providing comfort for each other. I've seen it in action. It's a beautiful thing. But sometimes people come to church and they just put on a, you know, kind of put on a stiff upper lip and say, oh, I'm okay. You know, I'm okay. Yeah. Because what do we say all the time when somebody asks how we're doing? I'm fine. I'm fine. And sometimes that's true and sometimes it's not. And we have to be that way. I mean, we can't be like, hey, Drew, how you doing? Well, I'll tell you what, how long you got here? Here's the list. We have a society to, you know, live in. Time moves on. But it's okay to not be okay. And you know, it's a beautiful thing to comfort somebody, because here's the deal. We get to see God's comfort flow through us to somebody else, and we are participating in that. And not only are we helping somebody, not only are we glorifying God, but we are getting a front row participatory seat and watching the God of all comfort work. And it's a beautiful thing. It is a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful thing. So today, if you are in here and you're needing comfort, there's people around here who can comfort you. If you want to be a comforter, there are people in here that probably need you to do that. Maybe it's somebody outside these walls. But we're here for each other. That's the beautiful thing about a church, isn't it? It's a church, especially a church like this, where we rally around each other and we comfort and we pick people up when they're down and we celebrate when we celebrate and rejoice when it's time to rejoice. Friends, God loves you so much. He is your heavenly Father, and He is the God of all comfort. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for being the God of all comfort, and we thank you for preparing us to be participatory in that process of comforting one another. I give thanks to this church, Lord, that understands this. But there's probably somebody that you may put in our path today or this week who just needs a pat on the shoulder, or maybe a hug, or maybe an hour of our time so that we can just listen. We thank you for the Bible and Holy Spirit. We thank you for your presence in us. We pray all these things in Jesus' most holy name. Amen. Let us stand as we are able as we continue to worship our Father. Amen. How about it for our praise band, huh? Yeah. Praise God. Praise God for the talents that they've been given. Let us receive this blessing as we go forth. Most gracious Heavenly Father, help us to be participatory agents in your comforting, Lord. We thank you for being the God of all comfort. There are people who need comfort. There are people that will need comfort. Probably all of us will at one point need comforted, Lord. And we thank you for your holy word, and we thank you for the Holy Spirit. We praise you, Lord, and we pray all this in Jesus' almighty name. Amen.
This is amazing grace.